let's start by asking the very basic, most basic question. When you decide for a show and an idea, how do you know the show is worthy of series potential versus just a moment, an episode?
With my show, I watched Mark Wahlberg and his friends, and I thought there was plenty of life to that. I thought it could go for a while, so it seemed like there were many different directions to take it, and that's how it went.
Right. That's what you thought, but how do you feel now?
No, I don't feel there's anything left. Dying now.
Right. Anybody else have any experiences in maybe pitching a show or thinking about a show and then realizing that may not be an actual series?
I think the question you always ask with a series is what can sustain? What can you see, episode 60 or episode 90 looking like? And if it's a show that's a relationship show, do you have enough of a sense of the world and enough of a sense of the complications for the relationships that will ultimately get you there? And if it's something that's leans more on genre, like a procedural show or mission show or something like that, can you see twists and turns to keep your formula fresh over the course of 50 or 100 episodes? Is there the potential for introducing new characters? If it's something that's a little bit more of the CSI sort of procedural, so after you've seen these same guys do the same kind of cases, that you can introduce new elements that are organic to the storytelling. And if it's a show like my show Castle, which has the mystery element but also has a very strong relationship component, can you ensure that there's enough juice in that relationship and enough complication in that relationship to keep people coming back week after week after week after week? And having done work in the feature world as well as in the TV world, there are ideas that are clearly feature ideas because they're closed-ended. And as much as you want to think that they would be good for the small screen, they don't translate because you have a resolution in mind. And then the question is, if you have an idea like that, is how far out can you stretch the resolution so it makes it interesting to the network as a product for them, because if you have a series that runs 2 years and you get it up on its feet, there are a lot of startup costs. And, a two-year product isn't as interesting to them as a 4 or 5 year product. So that's my two cents.
Well, on the 1 hour side, I was told very early on in my career that there's only four types of shows: cop, doctor, lawyer, and family. Family fitting into a very loose category that would be soap, meaning it's about the characters and their interrelationships over time, and it's highly serialized. Despite the fact that you see lots and lots of shows being promoted as though they're feature films, in other words, bus ads, billboards, big high concept ideas, which we talked about in the last panel, tentpole shows designed to get your attention right away, I still find that in 1 hour, that form pretty much holds true. Castle, despite the fact that it's about the relationship between those two characters and the wonderful dialogue between them, there still is a murder to be solved. House, it's a big lead character, the doctor who hates patients. So what we're all looking for in the 1 hour world is we're looking on variations on those four show ideas that have been done 12 billion times in every variation. Your job is to come up with the newest, latest one that we've never heard of before. So for 1 hour television, I like to think of it a little bit like a wedding analogy, like old, new, borrowed blue. You're treading on territory no matter what 1 hour you're doing, because they've all been done before in one form or another, but you're just looking for that fresh angle, that twist, that, I knew when I heard the pitch for House, boom, doctor who hates patients, won't even speak to them. I'm like, wow, never seen that before. So you can make this guy a total asshole for the whole hour, but he's saving people's lives, so we still like him. I mean, that's what Cop, Doctor, and Lawyer does, is it creates a heroic franchise for which your characters to operate through, so we kind of like them no matter how jerky they are. And that's one of the paradigms for one-hour show creation. I can't say what it is for half hour.
When I did the Bernie Mac show, in my mind, that was about kids are terrorists, and I do not negotiate with terrorists. You know? and that was all I needed, because I got to keep it simple for my scatterbrain. But I tried to tell that story every single week and just use different ways to tell that particular story. You know, and then you can be as inventive or creative as you want, as long as you know the story that you're trying to tell. You know, so that's what I always try thinking of.
Well, a friend of mine wrote on House the first year, a junior writer, and he said to the show boss, he goes, I don't like the way you're doing the show. It's the same form every week.
Right.
And so
that's
option
what TV
was canceled.
Is. That's kind of what television is. Margaret, what's your biggest worry when you are thinking about a show and say, this is it good enough? What's the on top of your list about making sure it's great?
Will it suck? You know, I got to work on this show, Boardwalk Empire, this year that hasn't come out yet, where we got to literally write a 13-hour movie. And we got to explore. So we got to, and the scripts had to be, our showrunner wanted the scripts to be 85 pages long. And we got to go, it wasn't the same story every week. It was actually serialized. It's very serialized. And so you, to watch the show, it's like damages. You are going to have to know what came before, but you've also got to hope the episode is so riveting and so exciting that it will hook the audience. So it was really fun to write out of that. You know, what is it going to be? What is the franchise? What is the franchise? What is the story engine? You know, where the story engine got to be whatever we wanted it. It was the world of Atlantic City, Prohibition, the birth of the mob. So we got to make the story pretty much whatever we wanted the story to be, and we didn't have to. But when you write for a network, you've got to be able to, like what you said so brilliantly, it's, you know, kids are terrorists and I don't negotiate with terrorists. That's show. It's two different worlds, and sometimes you pitch a show and they're like, to a network, and or you're working with the studio and they're like, that's such a cable idea, and you, no network will ever go there. You know, a network, that there's a big difference between what you can write for a network and what you can write for cable right now, and it's, I don't think the worlds have ever been farther apart, having worked in both.
We have a joke amongst the staff at Castle, you know, when we turn in the script, it's like the folks at the network and studio get together on Monday and they say, did you read the script? Yeah, it was interesting.
Well, I have a question for both Doug and Larry, which is, when you created Entourage, you were with Mark and his, you're using him as producer, and also as his, bringing him into the room, saying, "Look, I can use his life." Right? I mean, that's the. And when you were doing Bernie and Whoopi, you've attached yourself to talent, yeah, in one shape or another to sell the show.
Yeah, I mean, with me, Mark was, you know, the sale was over. You know, once Mark walked in the room, I said, "It's him and his friends," but that really ultimately didn't mean anything. It took 2.5 years, you know, of draft after draft after draft, right, to actually get it where it was. So there's one thing selling the idea, which at the time I thought was like, oh my God, I'm a hero. And then 2.5 years later of, okay, well, we don't really care if Mark does that. It's right, not that interesting. So what are we going to do that is interesting? So,
but even talking about that, and Larry, you could, uh-huh, to actually have that person in the room to get to that sale is, oh, yeah, what everybody, you need to get through the gauntlet. And I'd like to describe, actually, for everybody, the process of that gauntlet. Mm-hmm. From the moment when you walk into that room and sort of figure out how you're going to sell the idea, or write a spec and hope that sells, and, you know, what you need in order to do that. So walking in with talent was a big help, I assume.
Oh, it always is. It always is, you know. And Bernie was so charismatic, too. You know, I mean, he walks into the room, they're like, oh, shit, it's Bernie Mac. You know, who's Bernie Mac? I don't know. You know, it was kind of like the feeling. But, you know, and, whenever you have talent and you have a good idea, it's, you know, it's good to have them there. But you always want to make sure you're taking the lead on something, too. You know, you never want to be you know, especially as a writer, it's one of the toughest things is making sure that you're guiding that project, you know, from your point of view. Because a lot of times talent will just have these crazy ideas where they say, well, I never did that. Motherfucker, it's a story. Who cares what you did, you know? we're writing this stuff now, you know. I don't care what actually happened when you were a kid.
You know? Writing it now. That's the double-edged sword,
like
right?
That, talent.
Well, it depends who it is, you know. No, but you have to be firm. I'll give you an example. I was the first show that I did was the PJs with Eddie Murphy. Now, it doesn't get bigger box office-wise than Eddie Murphy, huge star, you know. And I had to learn how to manage him as a producer because you have to be the boss. But, you know, he's going to respect you to a certain point, but he's going to try to run over you. When I say he, I mean this type of star will try that, not him personally. But it's like dog smelling fear, you know. It's that type of thing. And I remember it was very early on, and we had a voice record, and Eddie was in a really foul mood, and nobody wanted to be there trying to say what to do. And you could never get another take out of him and that kind of stuff if he wasn't in a good mood. So I, of course, I have to direct it, you know. And it was very quiet through most of it. And he said, what do you think if I did? And he pitched something, you know. And I went, well, and he goes, well, if you got to look at the ceiling, then it can't be funny. You know, and I said, okay, well, here, why don't we try this? And instead of appeasing him, instead of saying, no, we'll go ahead and do what you do, I came up with something to try to, I was listening to what wasn't working, and I tried to create a solution instead of just being a yes man and just giving in. Like, I showed him that I was a leader and kind of guiding the way, and we never had any issues. Like, after he really respected that I was the boss, you know. And then, you know, they do their thing anyway, whatever. But talent, it's a very tough thing to deal with sometimes, but it can be very, very helpful when you're actually selling it.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you can get a piece of talent that's worth something. I mean, for me, Mark was just a producer, which was, again, why it was easy to sell a script, but it really didn't have anything to do with making the show unless Mark was going to be in it.
Right. But they knew going in that they were also going to advertise him when they go through, and that helps. If you know what the commercial is.
I mean, it all helped. But the sales pitch of this, Larry took the lead. I kind of just sat there. I've done 50 pitches where I take the lead. This one, you know, Ari Emanuel took the lead, and he said, it's Mark and his friends. This guy's going to write it. If it sucks, we'll fire him, and we'll get someone else to do it. So, you know, and again, when it was over, I was like, thanks, everybody, for getting me here. And then I realized you got to get the script to the place where they're
rising. So how do you all judge the marketplace and decide when's the right time to go out with your idea? And whether you think this is an idea for this season versus last season or next season?
Well, a couple of ways. The traditional selling season, again, I'm speaking about one-hour dramas here. They open their doors in July, August, and September, early October, to hear pitches for new one-hour shows that will be on in the fall of 2010. So we're starting to pitch now, and we will pitch for 2 or 3 months. You set up your pitch meetings through the studio, who's your financial partner, and you go to pitch to your network, who in today's world is usually a sister company of your studio. So for instance, I work for ABC Studios, we go sell to ABC Network. In terms of the pitch, these guys are smart to try to create packages of writing talent and acting talent. That's particularly valuable in the half-hour world because there's a limited number of people who mean anything. Bernie Mac means something. Mark Wahlberg, even just his feature cachet, means something. In one-hour drama, there's less attachment of an enormous star unless, you know, we were to find, you know, Russell Crowe wants to come do TV. That would mean something. But but really, for me, it's more about making sure that when I'm walking in the door with that pitch, like I said before, that I feel like the pitch is in the kind of shape. It's like an actor going to an audition. The pitch has to be well rehearsed. It has to grip you from the minute you start to hear it. They have to feel in that room the excitement as though they're watching a promo for the show that's going to be on in the fall. You need to get them excited. I have believed this for many, many years. They buy 60 scripts at ABC, one-hour dramas. Before a single word is written on any one of them, they can make a list of the 10 that they're probably going to pick up. Mm. Not a word has been written, but they know. Those are the pitches that when you walk out of the room, they're bubbling inside. They're so excited. Now, a few of those shows will just turn out to be absolute crap and won't get picked up. A few ones out of the other 50 will end up being brilliant scripts and raised to the surface. But still, those 10 out of those 60 ideas will be front runners. So I spend a lot of time preparing to make the pitch an exciting experience for them. I have a scripted pitch. I test it out on my wife, on my friends. You know, I actually overdo it a little bit so that when I'm in there pitching it to them, I'm incredibly comfortable. I know it backwards and forwards. I know where the joke, where the moments are going to be, where they're going to react. And then I get up and leave as quickly as possible.
But you're not kidding about that. You sell it and you go, right?
Yeah. And to be honest, you know, I've had this happen a bunch of different times where you get the expression I like to use is their panties are so in a twist that they buy it right in the room. Like they don't even let you get out of the room. They're like, okay, we're good. Let's just, you know, and then of course, as Doug said, then comes the actual work, writing the thing and turning what sounds like this great idea into an actual script that works. And I find more often these days they're asking me, what does the poster look like for the TV show? Mm-hmm. Say, mm-hmm. How do we promote this?
I actually had to make a poster. Wow. Before, God, this just happened. It all happened so fast. Anyway, CBS, I had a pilot at CBS. For them to pick up the pilot, because they were on the fence to make the pilot, I had to design the poster, and they wanted the prototype actors in each role on the poster. And so I went to Warner's, to their advertising, and I had to come up with the tagline, and I had like 50 taglines I wrote in, you know, one night, and I picked out the actors, and there was all this discussion back and forth, who would be the dad, who would be the mom, who would be the kids, you know, and then we literally doctored a poster and took all those actors' heads and designed a poster and put the tag on it and sent it to CBS, and then they said, okay, we'll make the pilot then. And that's how, so it's all about this marketing is huge. You need, and it's not always about attaching talent, because you can live by the sword and die by the sword. What you think is an exciting piece of talent, they go, oh, we did a pilot with him mm-hmm. last year, he was impossible, we can't work with him again. You know, you don't know all the, you know, the agents are telling you one thing. You have to really do deep research, deep background on anybody that you attach in terms of what their relationships are around town, if you're going to do that.
I think it's also important to do your homework in terms of the marketplace before you go out with your pitch, before you put your pitch together, because each network is trying to create a brand identity. So a show that would be perfect for Fox would not live on ABC, because ABC just has a different mentality. You know, CBS has a very strong point of view on what their brand is and what kind of shows live there. And sometimes, you know, it pays to be a little bit mercenary if you want to navigate the waters and go in and find out what shows they feel their light on, and to see if that meshes with a concept that you have, and then you can tailor it for that particular marketplace. I mean, you know, you start out being a writer with a very idealistic point of view of being able to create something, but ultimately this is a business where if you're going 22 episodes and your pattern budget's $3 million, it's a $66 million enterprise for these guys to buy into, and they have to make sure that as a property for them, it meshes with their corporate identity, it is friendly with the shows that it leads into or comes out of. There's all this stuff that goes into it that has nothing to do with how well the script is written, with how good the idea is, and you can have an idea that's great that for some reason doesn't make it that year, and then somebody will come along with something similar the next year, and because of what they're looking for, or because of the kind of talent attachments, or, you know, just because of whatever the kismet of the world is, it works that year. And, you know, the pilots every year, if you read them over and over again, the ones they buy, they're all kind of familiar, you know, and they just have different kinds of elements. And I think those of us who have gotten shows picked up, you know, yes, there's a lot of talent on this panel, but there's also the stars aligning, and there's also being cognizant of the business elements and how to work those business elements to your advantage.
But I think you work very, very closely with your studio. I mean, you don't have a studio. See, HBO, you don't normally have a studio. HBO is the studio and the network, but like I've worked with Warner Brothers, I work very closely with them to say, I go in for like pre-meetings, you know, what do the various networks want? What are they looking for? What talent is available? Where are they, you know, what do you know? So, because I'm not going to go in and, for a network and go, you know, pitch this show I've always wanted to write about a water bottle with, I know nobody wants to write a show about a water bottle. It's just a waste of everybody's time. So I think there's always, you know, as much as I want to be led by my creativity, I can find a way to tell a story I've always wanted to tell within what I think that is that they want to buy at this time. You know, you have to really, otherwise they're not going to want to come back and do business with you again. And I think you have to be really smart that way. I mean, like, Matt Weiner's a really good friend of mine, and that Mad Men was his spec script, and you know, no network was going to make that script, and he's really, but he loved that script, and he was working on The Sopranos, and it actually got him The Sopranos, because David Chase loved that spec, and he'd been writing, you know, he was your journeyman half-hour writer, he was working on Becker and things like that, and you know, he wrote a script that he really loved, but he knew no network would ever make, but it ultimately, that script is what, you know, cashed it all in for him, so it's not like you, but he also had to feed his family, he has four kids, you know, so it's like this constant.
And they're terrorists.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're terrorists.
But you know, so you're kind, you know, as much as you go, oh, I want to know what they already want, if you have that show within you that you absolutely must write and that story you must tell, then you must tell it. You just may not be the show that you're going to sell to
I always feel there's kind of a balance, you know, because I always feel they'd never know what they want. And I always assume that and I'm usually right. But I always feel there's a balance. And for me personally, because everybody does it differently, I go through three things. And the first thing is, what do I really want to talk about right now? Like, what's going on with me, you know? And like when I did the Bernie Mac show, all of these things lined up, fortunately. Like, what's important to me? What is an issue? What's something I want to dramatize in my life right at this moment? The second thing is, what's going on in the culture? I kind of look at, like, what are people, what's going on with people now? You know, and I remember creating the Bernie Mac show, I was going through, my wife and I had a tough time with raising kids at the time. There were some issues there, and I noticed it was kind of in the culture, too. You know, of all these kids taking over, turning their parents into the police and crap like that, you know. And I just felt there was a zeitgeist going on. And the third thing is what's going on in the marketplace, you know. And I noticed in the marketplace there weren't a lot of single camera comedies at the time. There certainly weren't a lot of black family shows at the time, you know. There wasn't this particular type of visual show that I was thinking of. So I thought, well, maybe there's a place to make this in the marketplace, you know. If there was something like that already, then I would have had second thoughts about pitching that particular thing. So I always kind of look at all three things, and hopefully it'll line up. And sometimes one is maybe a little more stronger than the other. Sometimes my vision of something may be a little stronger than everything else, you know, or my feeling of what I can fill in the marketplace may be stronger than something else. But it's nice when there's kind of a balance, you know, for me, I guess.
How much do you take studios and slash networks, or in your case, the same, their notes when it comes to the beginning concept before it's even the fruition?
Well, I mean, at the beginning, I didn't have any choice. I mean, they weren't going to make it if I didn't take their notes.
Right.
And now, fortunately, they've put their trust in me, so I really have no notes anymore, which is a great experience. But the first season was, you know, was torturous. I mean, it was really probably from selling it to on the air was almost 3 years.
So how'd you navigate that first season?
It was very difficult. I mean, it was a very tough process, but as I was talking to Larry, Carolyn Strauss, who was over at HBO at the time, was so great, and she actually had good points and good notes, but, you know, I think it was a show that they didn't necessarily believe in, you know. I think, again, Ari and Mark, it was like, okay, here we go, but if Mark's not playing the movie star, who is? And, you know, there would be notes coming in like, what if we just see the movie star's feet and we never see them? And I said, I don't think that's going to be very interesting to people. So, you know, until we really found the guy who people believed was a movie star, I don't think it was ever real to anybody except me, who just kept going and going and going. And, you know, I mean, the WGA probably shouldn't hear this, because they'll file some grievances, but I probably wrote 30 drafts. I mean, they just kept noting me. So, but it, you know, it's what you have to do to get through the process. So,
mm-hmm. Those of you who work with studios, how do you know that their information is right, and how do you deal with their notes when their notes go against what the network is saying? I mean,
Well, if the recent reorganization of ABC Studios and Network is any indication, it's been a really rough time there for the last 3 or 4 years, trying to navigate two organizations that should be perfectly under one roof and functioning synergistically and who aren't. And so, for my money, I listen to what they have to say, and oftentimes the note or the solution that they're proposing may be absurd. However, underneath it, they're getting at something. In other words, I don't find most of the studio and network people that I deal with to be morons. They're actually smart people, and they're trying to express what they think is wrong with the script. Sometimes that has the effect of diluting it, making it flatter for everybody. So you try to, I mean, my simple rule of thumb is this: I never criticize a note in the moment. I wait for 2 days, and then I call back and say, you know that note you gave me? I tried to make it work. I couldn't make it work. So like I put it on me. Mm-hmm. And then they go, oh, really? Oh, yeah. But if you're right in the room there, and they say, hey, you know, we think the second act out is a little light. No, it isn't. Yeah, if you're arguing right, you're challenging them in the moment. You know, you're making them look stupid. So I just always have a smile on my face as I take all the notes, and then call back later and say, here are the ones I did, and those other ones I just wasn't good enough to make work. And you just put it on you.
But being defensive never helps. And I think Chris is absolutely right. Where you know what the studio and network provide you with is your first audience, and if they're unsatisfied with something in the script, then odds are your audience will be unsatisfied with that moment. Now you might, if your second act out it seems light on the page, you might have a way for the actor to deliver the line where it's great. You know, if on the page your act out line is, it doesn't look like anything on the page, but if you have a guy who can deliver that, that can encapsulate something. So, but part of it is just understanding how your first audience is reacting to the material, because we all write with a context in our head, and we may or may not have gotten that context on paper. So we have to go back and look at it. Yes, you know, right. Most times now, I think that they're good enough not to suggest solutions, but if they can delineate problems in how they're viewing the material, then you can go back and say, you know what, my intent is for the audience experience to be this. I am not achieving that. Now it's time for me to exercise my craft and make it better. Defensiveness I think defensiveness is for insecure writers. Secure writers.
And I think you're wrong.
Good at stuff.
Whatever.
How many pilots have you gotten on? Throw down.
Now, I think though that when they give you a note that like, you know, she should eat from a bowl of pretzels, and you're like, oh my god, and then I'll go, okay. Instead of getting pissed or defensive, I'll go, and they don't want to tell you what to do. But I'll always say, but then when the note is so stupid and they're so behind some note that's just sort of bizarre like that, you go, give me the bad pitch. And they'll go, what? I go, give me the bad pitch. Well, she eats the pretzel, she chokes and she dies. And she can't get, there's no, you know. And I go, okay, I got it. All right, now I know what you, so sometimes, and I go, oh, they want the stakes to be much higher, they want this, they want, okay, fine. And sometimes, you know, you say, just give me the bad, don't, no, it's okay, give me the bad pitch. And they'll tell you, all right, that's, and it's a much quicker, I find it's a much quicker way to get to what it is they're actually trying to tell you, because so often they'll couch it in what they think is writer language, and they, you know, and they start off, you know, we're really excited about this, you know, and you realize they have 10 pages of notes in front of them. Yeah. So you go, all right, how am I going to get through this, because they're going to talk to me in writer speak.
And they use the term we, you know, and let's see if we can, and I'm like, okay, well, why don't you take that scene and I'll take this scene.
I know, and so you go, okay, and you realize there's this huge, I just got a group of notes on a TV movie for HBO that were just, you know, written all in writer speak, and it was like, I wish you'd just given me your notes that you wrote in-house on this script. I'd be much better off. I'm now going to spend months deciphering this document, when really, this scene sucks, we didn't like it, we didn't get it, it's still in her head. Fine. You know what I mean? It'd be like so, that would be so, and so I'm always trying to coax it out of them, whatever their truth is, because I'm not going to write the bowl of pretzels. But, you know, maybe she's going to trip on the 4-inch heels that she shouldn't have bought that are on the credit card that's maxed out, and she's going to almost kill herself. Not, do you know what I mean? I'll take it somewhere.
And she'll fall face first into the bowl of pretzels.
Right, right. So it's like you're always, there's this element there, there's this moment, and it happens. And if you go to series, depending on who your network is, there's a lot of deciphering, and it has to be politically correct. You have to be politically correct. They're trying to be politically correct with you. You're trying to be politically correct with them, you know, and not get pissed. And I just always think it's, no, give me the bad, come on, give me the bad pitch.
Yeah, there's a lot of politics. There's
I like the pretzels about. More and more, the more I think about
yeah.
it. It's a damn fine pitch.
That's
you know, Jay, I think there's the other side of it, too, especially when you're creating a show. There's a different thing than when you're in production, you know. And you certainly don't want to be too defensive about things. And there is a skill set that is you acquire with how to listen, a lot of what Margaret's saying, to how to decipher. You know, there are notes I look as the Rosetta Stone all the time, you know, I'm trying to figure it out. But there are also points when I think you have to make a stand, but you have to figure out how to make that stand diplomatically. Because there are certain things that you have to stand up for in a pilot that are going to shape the actual show that are very specific and could be very important. You know, and you have to know what those things are. There are certain things in a pilot that may be lateral moves that could be very easy to give on and won't really affect it. But there could be some things that are very, very important to telling a story. When I was doing the Bernie Mac show, they really wanted to have that show in front of an audience. Now, if I go into their shoes, I can understand why. Bernie Mac's a comedian, you know. He kills in front of an audience, you know. It makes sense. That's what they would want to do. From my point of view, that doesn't work for the type of story that I want to tell on a lot of different levels. And the biggest reason was that I can't compete with that Bernie Mac, the Bernie Mac that says motherfucker pussy and all that stuff, you know. I can't compete with him. He's too funny on stage if I'm in front of an audience. I can't tell that story. That expectation's too high. The story I wanted to tell was more inside of here, was an inward-outward story that I can tell with a single camera. So I had to figure out a way to get them on my side and making them feel like we all won. So that's a skill set. I just lied and said Bernie didn't want to do it because he had some issue or something, you know, with, and he got real angry. They said, oh, thanks for telling us.
No, you have to protect your content. So, you know,
yeah, like, you have to navigate. There's, I remember another note in my pilot was that they wanted me to reshoot like this major portion of it, and I'm like, I can't do that, you know. But I had run out of ways to fight them. You know, I had used all my tricks. You know, I lied. I used Bernie in a way. You know, I brought in the star. You know. So I ran out of my little tricks to win. And I was thinking, how am I going to get this? You know, I can't do this. No, you know. And I just figured I would stall. I would just act like I didn't hear it and just start producing the show and just wait till it's too late to actually do the note.
Yeah, I ran out the clock.
And I would keep getting memos, call Sandy, he wants to talk about the thing. Oh, okay. And then I'd just forget. And then by the time I actually, then they called an emergency lunch that I had. And he said, you have to do this. And I go, Sandy, we premiere in a week. There's no time. I said, there's no time to do it, you know. So
do it episode 4.
Exactly.
Along those lines, when you're writing your pilot and you're trying to you think about a series in a long-term kind of way, what are all the great things? How do you decide what's the pilot story you're going to promote? Is it the story that is the sexiest to the network? Is it the story that's it's going to test the best in front of test audiences? You know, for those who have to deal with that. Is it something that just you know? Is just is it the premise? What do you decide? How do you?
Well, that's an easy one for me, and it's a good question. On a pilot, a typical pilot will shoot for 13 to 16 days. Your typical episode will shoot for 8 days. So you're going to spend at least twice as much money making your pilot. So everything, the pilot also has a bunch of responsibilities. It serves to create an introduction to the 7 or 8 regular characters who hopefully we're going to fall in love with and want to invite into our living rooms every single week. That's television. It's people you want to invite into the comfort of your own home.
That's the network.
Network television.
You don't want to invite Glenn Close home.
That's true. That is true. Well, you're interested in inviting her into your home, at least to watch her do her evil doings. But you're correct. That's a network.
She'll kill your dog.
As long as she stays on the other side of the glass.
And I think, you know, your responsibility is to come up with a story that reveals those characters in the most, in the manner in which you want them introduced. And I usually choose a pilot story for the first episode that's probably just a little bigger. You know, just if it's going to cost a little bit more to make that story work, that's fine. It's the pilot. It should definitely be a story that accrues to the benefit of your lead characters. So oftentimes, for instance, you'll see, and I do a lot of cop pilots and stuff, oftentimes it's about the rescue of a missing child in the pilot story, because everybody can get on board with that. It's got a satisfactory resolution, and so yeah, I mean that.
Do you find that actually helps with testing because they all test?
Well, I mean, you'll hear a million stories from these writers here where you stand in these rooms. I don't know if you had to do this, Doug, but like, I've been in a million of these rooms. They're these glass 2000, from the year 2525, like a room where they're projecting your pilot on a screen, and there are 50 people sitting there. They all have dials. When they see something they like, they turn it to the right. When they see something they don't like, they turn it to the left. You sit behind these one-way mirrored glass walls. You watch your show being projected up on a TV. There's a graph for the men and the women.
As blue
the men
and red.
Start to like something, yeah, the blue goes up because the men like it. You're sitting there. It's the most insane process that's ever existed, because every single line of dialogue and everything that happens on the screen is being second by second parsed by 50 people they found on Reseda Boulevard. We did a test on an Easter Sunday. I said, who the hell is like not free? Who's free to come
with
to
their family
for the afternoon?
Well, my test was a little different. My test was at Mark Wahlberg's
Hello,
house.
Hello, we're in Hollywood.
My test was at Mark Wahlberg's house, and he had his whole crew over there. And the second Adrian Grenier, whoever's seen the show's character, came on, they all went, all of them were like, Mark could kick the shit out of that guy. And it did not stop from there. Every comment was about how Mark could beat this one up, that one up.
Yeah. That's great.
We had something similar on Frasier.
But what also happens is that's hysterical to me is we did a show, Football Wives, the British version. We did the American version of it for ABC, and we're testing it. And there's this scene where a bunch of the star quarterbacks finish practice, and he's in the shower, and you come in and you see these men, all naked men, walking around the shower, and I'm watching the dials, and the men's dial goes like tanks. The women's dial's going way up. Then suddenly a character steps in. You don't know who it is, but it's the sister of one of the players, and suddenly it's about to be a sex scene in the shower, and but like a gratuitous sex scene where the woman's making a really gross advance on the guy in the shower. The women's monitor goes, the men's monitor goes, way up. And you're watching it go through the whole thing. And frankly, it's a completely unscientific, insane process. But we're talking about a business and a product, so to speak, that is totally indefinable. Like, who knows what shows are going to work? Some shows that have tested terribly are huge hits. Shows that test great bomb out all the time.
I think they use test results only as they want them. I had a pilot this year, and it was quote unquote their highest testing pilot, and they didn't pick it up because one person didn't like it. So it's
Flesh.
He has one syllable in his name. I'll say that. But he, you can test a night. It was funny, I had Jason Lewis from Sex and the City was in my pilot, but he just had one scene. And of course, it was the same thing, goes up and the men go, and they were like, CBS called me because they knew some of the test results, and they said, cut a longer close-up of Jason in, because then your test numbers go even higher. Do you know what I mean? And it was like, and then we had like this makeout scene in a car with a woman is at the chiropractor, and she wants to be her breast implants. Anyway, it's a long story. Anyway, again, men goes up, women go down, and they're like going, all right, cut away from the breasts quicker, because then the women go, and it's also manipulated. It's such bullshit, you know. And it really, you can have shitty. There's a pilot that had horrible testing, and that's the one that, and people were repulsed by it. And they test in Vegas, and apparently people were walking out, and that's the one they picked up. So I don't, you know. And HBO's great because the testing, when I tested at HBO for a movie I wrote there, it was just a bunch of people in a room and you heard everything they said. It was none of the graphs and super science. You had to hear what they said, which was, I actually thought was better than watching these clinical numbers.
Sure.
I thought it was better.
Well, not only that, after the testing, they separate people into rooms, men 18 to 34, women 34 to 49, and then they're through one-way glass also, and there's a moderator talking to 10 of them, and they all go, okay, you all have a slip of paper in front of you. Did you like the show? Put down 10 being the best, 1 being the worst. Everybody hold up their numbers, and you're sitting there behind the glass going, oh God, now my fate's about to be decided. And people hold up their things, and then you have a little typewriter from behind your one-way glass where you can ask questions to the moderator, secretly slip him some questions in there.
And it doesn't always mean...
Are you an idiot?
Doesn't always mean anything.
Ask them that.
Right.
Ask them if they're idiots.
Did you graduate high school?
How many times have you been to jail?
Some of those questions are irrelevant because people could say they don't like it, but they're still going to watch it. Oh, I hate that guy. Oh,
well,
but I got to watch it.
People like, it's funny, you know, with House, because I had a lead in my pilot that was like House and tested super high, off the charts as a character. Because people, it was fun, this whole idea of characters have to be likable on TV, but I had a guy who was like Tony Soprano, you know, and it was network, and he tested super, super, super high. And so, and they loved the idea that they hated and loved the guy.
Well, Tony Soprano is very likable. The thing is, he's just not a positive character. Like, there's a difference. He's negative traits, but that's what makes him likable. Like, people confuse likability with having positive traits. They're not the same thing, you know. But my all-time favorite thing about testing is that the audience has no idea that I'm naked behind the glass.
That's good.
Good thing. Well, now they know.
Yeah. Actually, we didn't want to tell you this, but you thought there was a mirror.
Wait,
on the other
glass
side,
goes
actually.
That way?
Both ways.
How come I can't see them anymore?
But there's also another element to this, and you know, this is something that we had on Castle, and that, you know, as Chris said, the pilots are usually bigger. You know, they spend twice the time and twice the money on them, or not. In economically challenged times, they might ask you to do a presentation, which is a shortened version of your 1 hour, in which you basically take a 1 hour story, cut it in half or by two thirds, and you still have to tell the story. So then you have to go back into your material and figure out what you can cut so that it's still a satisfying experience for the audience. And you've spent all this time getting into a world, exploring a world, setting up expectations for the audience within a very narrow page count to begin with, because it used to be 48 minutes you had for your hour drama, now it's 42 minutes, and then suddenly you have to do a 28-minute version for it, and that's what's going to be tested, so it's not even your best foot forward. And then if you're lucky to get picked up, you've truncated all this stuff, and they ask you to go back and fill in the pilot, but you can't reshoot the scenes you've already shot to fill them out. So then you're adding scenes, and you end up with something that you have to be very deft, very clever with. Otherwise, it ends up being a Frankenstein. And you know, the presentation tested well, but the pilot is now incomprehensible because you've added all these scenes to try and replace the ones that were organic that you had to cut in order to tell a story that made sense in half the time. So there is that process that you have to navigate and that you have to get through.
I think that question you asked earlier, Jay, too, is really important, is how are you going to introduce the audience to this particular thing in that pilot episode? It is really a good question to ask yourself. You know, in a lot of shows, I guess the most common one is the starter type episode where something actually starts. You know, like
premise
someone starts
pilot.
A new job, you know, the premise pilot or whatever. But, you know, and, you know, not every show starts that way. Some kind of just day in the life, slice of life is not a bad way, you know. Or big event is another thing. Something interrupts the life, you know. But it is important because many times what a network will do is they won't show your pilot first, which is very frustrating in the creative process, you know, especially if that pilot in your mind is meant to be the first you know, part of that storytelling. So that can be a fight sometimes when they don't quite see that, you know. So it is, I think it is a really important question to ask yourself when you're thinking of a show. How am I introducing people to this particular world? Why am I starting on this particular day in the character's life, you know, in this particular time, you know? Or what's interesting about this particular thing?
And there's no formula. The story itself suggests how you need to start. The series itself suggests how you should get into it. Sorry, cut you off. Jump in.
No, I think Larry's mentioning a few things that are really valid, which is I always look when I go in to do a pitch, I go, what's the way I can make a personal connection with the executive sitting here? How do I make them interested? And I think this is now more relevant than ever. I'll give you a quick example. You know, you have your story and your show and why you want to do it, why it's personal to you, why you think it will sell, what its one sheet is, all of this stuff. But you're also trying to introduce the whole concept of your show to them in a way that makes them curious. So I remember going in to pitch something and I said, hey guys, like, you know, we get into the meeting where it's 15 minutes late, they've got 10 meetings in a row backed up. I said, guys, what's the most valuable commodity that there is in the today? What's the most valuable commodity? Gold? Money, it's time. It's time. We're all so busy. We're torn in all sorts of different directions. So we barely have time to even think about anything. Well, what if somebody was stealing an hour a day from you? So that for during that hour you could not recall nor account for your actions.
Are you talking about notes calls?
And so with that kind of like, so they're curious now. They're on the edge of their seat. And I said, well, John Henderson's a guy who works in suburban Virginia. He's got a wife. He's got a couple of kids. And he comes to discover that 1 hour a day is being stolen from him. And as he investigates, he discovers that that is for a nefarious purpose. And he comes to discover that he's chasing the world's most dangerous terrorist himself. So, okay. When you start off that way, they're curious. Really? Okay, he's the 60-minute man. 60 minutes stolen from him every day. It's coming up with some sort of big, and I thought, oh, I see the poster for this. We get that big actor they have a holding deal with, that sexy action guy, and he's standing there, and it says, John Henderson is chasing the world's most dangerous terrorist himself. So I have my one sheet. I know how they're going to promote it. I went, there was an actor on a huge holding deal at ABC. They had paid him a fortune to just hold him for just an ABC show. He had his choice of the 70 scripts. He chose mine. I called the head of the network. I said, hey, Steve, we got so-and-so. He's going to play the lead. And Steve said, really? You want him? I'm like, you idiot, you have the holding deal with him. But anyway, long story short, the point is that trying to find a way to make your pitch resonate with them, whether it's Larry's very relatable, hey, kids are terrorists, and I do not negotiate with terrorists. Okay, we all get it. I'm buying that the minute those words fly out of his mouth, and I don't even need to hear anything.
Pitch it again.
Very good.
I'm gonna try.
Let me ask a question about in the process when a pilot's sold, then comes the outline before the script. How much do you give them in the outline before the script comes in? Or do you give them just a little bit? Do you give them credible details? Where do you go with that?
Probably depends what it is, you know. The PJs was very specific. We actually did a, you know, there was a lot of character design that we even had to do first before we started writing. And what we did was Steve Tompkins and I, we did a little presentation type thing, a little 5-minute thing, which kind of showed what the world was, since it was animation and that sort of thing, claymation. And we gave a general idea of what the pilot story was about, but not broken out too far. And there were so many elements that that's pretty much all we needed to go off and do it, you know. It's funny, for the Bernie Mac show, I never turned in an outline. Because I didn't know how the hell I was going to write it, to be honest with you. I was scared to death when I wrote that. And I just stayed under the radar for as long as possible. And then, like, after, you know, like a month or so, are we going to get an outline or anything? I said, you know what, I'm just doing, like, an outline draft. You know, that's basically the outline. You know? So,
Doug, did you have to do outline? Many of the 30 drafts were ready?
You know what Larry said, I did for 2 years, and finally they gave up on, I didn't know how to write an outline. I didn't know what that meant. And I just kept avoiding it like Larry did, and I've never written an outline for them in 7 years, even though they still ask, like, can we get an outline? Every time the season starts, like, are we getting outlines? I'm like, yeah, you know, probably.
I'll be submitting an outline with slug lines, scene descriptions, and dialogue.
Correct in the outline.
I found that every time, and outlines to me are very useful in the 1 hour drama game to just have a game plan to know where you're going. You often deviate from that. The longer the outline, the more notes I get and the less they like it. So it's just less is more. I do a 1 hour outline. I don't make it more than 6 or 7 pages. I just do a very brief description of the conflict in each scene. When I try to elaborate, when I try to tell you what they're going to be saying, when I try to figure out how we're buttoning the scene and transitioning into the next one, it just gets, suddenly it's 20 pages long, but it has none of the charm of good dialogue or the gracefulness of
it's too manipulative.
It's what?
I feel it's too manipulative. I go, I haven't written it yet. I don't know. I'll write it and then I'll tell you. You know.
I mean, I understand why, for the purposes of network television, they kind of want to know what they're spending their $3 million on. So, but I just think less is more. Just less is more.
The reality is, it's who are you and who are you working for? Because I think if you're a person at a particular level who has delivered over and over again, and the show has launched, they need less and less because you've earned their confidence. But there's some places where the internal discussion, the amount of internal discussion, depending on how dysfunctional the place is, requires the executives to have a much better command of the specifics of the story. So they will basically, part of the requirement of the chain of delivering the creative is to have, you know, a story arena document, you know, a page and a half to 2 pages as to ballpark what are you about. Mm-hmm. So they're comfortable in that world. And then, you know, an outline so they can go to whoever they're responsible for and have some knowledge of the story. The thing you have to distinguish is that some of these things are not writing documents, they're sales documents, and they're for you to sell them on what you're going to do. And you have to be very careful what story elements you choose to include and what story elements you don't. And once you get a sense of who your executive is, you'll know that there are things that very deftly in the script that will be very well received, but if you do the one line on it, they'll have an immediate allergic reaction. So that's part of the process of learning how to deal with a chain of creative, but it's different at every place. I think, you know, at HBO, if you've delivered for them over and over again, they're fine. Mm-hmm. Whereas at a place like ABC, they need to know.
And one thing to keep in mind, when you know this is used for a chain of command for sales, I'm giving it to my boss so they know what your show is about. I always try to make sure the outline is written as much in story form as possible and not so much plotty. Like, I don't concern myself with what happened so much as what's happening to the character. So when they read it, they understand it more than get an intellectual sense of what's going on. I'll give an example. So it's more like in the first scene, the character feels disoriented because this happens, and so the character, you know, so and so really feels like this is going to happen, and because of this event, you know, that, like, writing it in the language of what's happening to the character and what's going on, because they understand the story more than just a plot, because they're reading so many things just to go, okay, that, what's going on there? What happens? Why does that go on? So you're answering the why and wherefores, you know, of what's going on with the character. I think is a very valuable thing, kind of a guide to writing an outline that's used for that specific purpose, you know, a simple kind of bullet thing, you know.
So you know,
a balance between that.
I would describe it this way, is instead of giving them the story to react to, you're telling them how they're going to react to the story.
Right.
And that's very helpful to them. And then, you know, it's your responsibility to execute it. But if you give them a document that isn't fully fleshed out, then they're not going to have a valid reaction to it. So you're just telling them what they're going to feel. And I think that puts them at ease.
Is there anything you can do once you've turned in the script? There's that helpless moment of, boy, I hope they like it. Is there anything that you can do to push it over the top? You said you made a poster to sell your show, and they were sort of deciding whether or not they were going to sort of make that show. What else? Do any of you have stories about how you sort of pushed it over the top?
Well, I think you have to get the studio. Yeah, I mean, you have to get the studio so invested that when they submit it to the network, they're standing behind it in a very passionate way and making phone calls at the highest level to the network.
And how do you get them invested?
You listen to their notes and you do a couple of drafts with them in house to get them all very, very involved. You know, so they feel invested. They have to feel emotionally invested in the process. I mean, you have to get them a little pregnant in the process of writing the script so that they'll go to bat for you. You need sort of face time with them. I find that you really have to engage that studio and empower them with this script, so again they turn it in feeling that it's undeniable in terms of being worthy to be greenlit as a pilot. And it's a seduction, but you go, I'll talk to them on the phone as many times as they want. I'll go in and meet them as many times as they want before we hand this script in, so they are really excited about it.
I find that alcohol often puts it over the top.
Okay.
One of the things, amongst the things that I've attempted to do to sell projects is, for instance, a show about FBI and Treasury agents who track the Byzantine money trails that criminals leave, a show cleverly entitled Money. I got the Pink Floyd song and had an editor friend of mine take shots from Miami Vice, like high-budget features, cool shots of bling and money and guns and yachts, and he cut a trailer to Pink Floyd's song Money, and I just went around to the four different networks and I said, hey, I'm going to give you the pitch in a second, but I just want you to feel kind of like what the vibe of the show is. And so suddenly, like, Pink Floyd, one of the top singles of all in history, comes on, and they're watching these like shots that we could never manage to produce ourselves because they're from $100 million features, and watching the thing, and I didn't, you know, like, basically each network president was just like, you know, this one guy took out his credit card and was like, how much? I'm buying. And so I barely even had to pitch that. So yes, props. They sold a big one at ABC, the Atlas, Captain Cook's Adventure Atlas. Well, Warner Brothers put up a couple grand. They made this beautiful leather-bound atlas where it had witches and warlocks, and it was about a young girl who discovers an atlas and goes and deals with these monsters here on Earth. Again, pilot got made, show didn't get picked up. But it's all part of, in service of creating for that network this excitement that, frankly, is more than the excitement they feel for your project over there. Mm-hmm. Because when it gets down to the end of the day and they're going to choose what 10 pilots they're going to make, it's a game of inches. I've always realized that. Like, whether yours or mine gets picked up, there's no difference. Throw a dart against the wall. It's just what little tiny intangibles are tipping the scale in your balance or in yours. In your case, if I'm in at HBO pitching my version of A Group of Friends, but mine's just about like guys from Teaneck, New Jersey I grew up with, and his is about guys, but he's got Wahlberg with him, well, the balance tilts there. So you're looking for every competitive advantage. It's why I'm suggesting in your pilot ideas, even in your pitch, do something to draw me in. Make me curious. Don't just go, it's about a man and a wife, and they're a husband and wife, and they solve crimes. Okay, what's special about that? What does that have to do with now? That's a show from 20 years ago called Heart to Heart. So
I do think, though, that what Chris is talking about can also be a double-edged sword, and you have to be smart about how you do it, because if you create excitement in the room for something that you ultimately can't deliver, which I think was probably one of the problems with Captain Cook's, because they're going to give you a very small amount of money to do it. So they've seen a trailer with boats and, you know, jet skis and, you know, clubs and money, and you end up with, you know, two detectives walking into a bullpen saying, hey, that yacht blew up. Because you don't have any money to go shoot it, that then when they're making a decision to go to series, they're going to say, you know, we had, you know, it just didn't live up to the promise. So you have to be very careful that you're selling it in the right way to get the excitement, so that ultimately when the script comes in and the budget comes in, it's something that can be executed within the exciting vision that you've articulated. And sometimes that's just character, you know.
Well, that's where House is, you know, that is such a great character. It's so, that's where the point of view of you as the writer. It's all about your point of view and how you write it. I mean, there are a million cop shows, there are a million everything shows, but like what David Shore did with House, how the point of view he gave, the way those characters, their different voices come out, the way his dialogue sounds, the way he stops a scene, the way he starts a scene, that's where it's all about the voice of the writer. And that's where selling, all of that goes away, and it becomes, listen to the way this man tells a story. No one tells a story like this man. No one told a story like David Chase. You know, The Sopranos, a mafia show, he's over the hill, you know, what's going to happen now, they're downsizing. We get a story that's only from the mind's eye of David Chase. And that's where you can go through all this stuff and you can write all these notes, but ultimately it's what you have to say about it. What do you have to say about a guy who's middle-aged and his business is downsizing? And he feels like he's useless. His point in this life is over. And he's at a turning point. And with his wife and with his children and with his lover and with his team and with the police and everything else. And that's what you have to say about it. And that's what makes a pilot sell. Ultimately, it's the idea, but it's what do you have to say about that idea versus that other guy. So it's like, yeah, Mark Wahlberg's there, but ultimately it's what those guys had to say about friendship. It's what you said about friendship. It's about what you said about the connective tissue between those guys that made that show unbelievably compelling. And, you know, I'm watching it going, I got a turtle. I got a turtle in my life. He's just as arrested as this guy. We got to push him out of the, you know what I mean? And it so ultimately at the end of the day, you can do all this stuff, but what's going to make, I think, a network or an audience love a show and want to watch it is the voice of you, is your voice, and what you have to say that no one else can say. Because no one else can say what you have to say, you know?
And it really is about, ultimately, most of the shows that are successful about universal themes through a new filter that we haven't been seeing, that we haven't seen before. You know, Tony Soprano going through that process is no different than most middle-aged guys trying to find relevance in their life. The thing about House that makes him so attractive is that I think the men that watch the show want to get away with just allowing their id to speak all the time. This is what I'm really thinking, but you know, we can't afford to. And they're very clever to put a woman in the show who wants to fix him, because I think that he presents, you know, he's an attractive, smart guy who presents a challenge to women who are like, if we only fixed him, he'd be great. So I think that you can get investments in a character in an unusual and interesting world that suddenly feels universal. So it's suddenly, you know, about friendship, you know, the way Entourage is, or about family the way Bernie Mac is.
If you look at the show Hung, I think that the friendship between a man and a woman that they're plotting out, I have not seen on television ever. I think there's a friendship between a man and a woman there that I realized, particularly with this week's episode, I'm not sure they, you know, they had to start it in the pilot, but I said, I haven't seen a man and a woman be friends like this on TV. I don't know, ever. And that, to me, was like, it's not about anything. That's why I'm going to watch the show.
And then Weeds is about, you know, a single mom. She could be divorced. In this case, her husband's dead. But she's just trying to figure out how to pay the bills, and it just gets her deeper and deeper. But, you know, anybody who's been in that situation and has had to make compromises and has had to figure out how to, you know, try to be a good parent under unusual circumstances can buy into that show.
Question I have for you guys is, you begin the process as a writer. In this particular process, you all have other things, actors, directors, and what have you, but you begin this particular process as a writer. How do you then process from writer when they give you a green light to writer-producer? And how do you protect your written vision or change it as it's going through the process of that pilot production?
Well, first, I think the director you hire is crucial. I think the director has to be someone that, like, I had a director on my last pilot who could point to, he'd never read the original draft, and he could point to everything in my current draft. He said, that line, that's a note. And I was like, oh, God. Oh, my God. No one could point to that, but he could. And I went, oh, he's so on to the way I write. This is going to be a good match. We're going to be a good match. This is going to work for us, you know. And that, so, because for me, I work so closely with a director. I love working with a director, and so for me, that's a huge, huge part of it, particularly with a pilot, where a director really puts their stamp on a pilot. It's so important that you're making the same show, and that he's taking your show to the next level. whatever that might
well,
be.
Well, I mean, that's true for some people. Some writers don't want a director to take their show to the next level. They want to keep exactly at the level they wrote it.
I'm one of those guys. I mean, but I mean, for me, you know, it's really important, especially early on in your career, to, you know, they'll do everything they can to force you out. I mean, they'll kill you to write the script, and then they'll, you know, in my case, Larry knows Steve mm-hmm. Tompkins. They brought him to be my boss after I worked on this script for 3 years. I'm like, I don't. What do you mean? And I actually hired him, but I didn't really get. I didn't understand it until like I hired him, and then I realized, oh, you're supposed to be watching me. And I think that it's especially, you know, if you do have a voice that you're trying to get out and you're trying to be specific, and it's important that you fight the battles. And again, you learn how to defer when need be. But I mean, the battles I had on this show were everything from, you know, I mean, Mark's from Boston, but I'm from New York, and I was very specific. I needed this more of a New York show. Mark's Irish, even though I didn't make my guys Jewish. They have a Jewish feeling about them in a certain way, and they'd come to me and say, you know, well, why do you have to cast people from New York? And I said, well, I wanted to have an authentic feel, and I wanted to feel like New Yorkers. Well, you know, you could find someone from Iowa that can play New York. And these battles went on day after day after day, and then, you know, you always get into, which is an uncomfortable thing, you get into the race thing, well, why aren't any of them black? And you go, well, just because I think these four guys that went to high school, it just, you know, it wouldn't feel authentic. And then they go, well, maybe you're a racist. And you start to go, well, all right, but it's really... It's
what does my racism have to do with this?
So I think it's really essential when you're starting to fight every battle, to hire, to surround yourself with people who believe in your vision, because I think the most successful shows are usually, they do, you know, have a singular voice, and then of course you bring in tremendous amount of people that need to help guide that. But if you let that slip away, that's when you end up with, you know, a disaster that you spend your life going, I can't believe I let that happen. So
it's really one thing you got to remember through the whole process, because the process at times will beat you up, the process will make you tired, the process will seduce you with, you know, flashy people who show up. But the one thing you always need to remember is your story. You got to remember your story, you got to protect your story. And everything should be looked at through the filter of, does this help me tell my story well or better? And that's hiring a director, that's hiring a DP, costume designer, production designer. Does this person filling this role help me tell my story better? And does this note that the studio is giving me, does executing it help me tell my story better? Does listening to the input that your star has, does that help me tell the story better? And if it doesn't, then you have to be, you know, strong enough, political enough, and deft enough to navigate those waters to get back to a place where you're telling the story better. When you're facing, you know, a 14-hour day and somebody's going to pull the plug and you're looking at a shot, and do you do the shot or do you do something else? Does this help me tell my story better? Do I need this to tell my story? And that's really the only thing you have to remember while you're navigating these waters. Now, how you respond to the stimuli that's coming to you, and how you play the politics, and how you play the game, and when you put your foot down, and how you compromise, that's all going to be different based upon the situation. But the fundamental tenet is telling your story well.
And it is very important. I agree with Doug 1,000% in getting people on your train, you know, and not having people who are fighting the train that you're on, because you're trying to make something that you see. And you may not have everything in there, but you know, your instincts are usually pretty right because it came out of your head, you know. And anybody that's fighting that, it's tough to deal with. So, and like what Margaret said, I love working with directors very closely, getting to them. I've been very fortunate to work with some good people. When I did Bernie Mac, I worked with Ken Quapis. And Ken and I actually sat down and we watched like some French New Wave films together, actually, like Breathless and stuff like that, because I was interested in the editing of it and I wanted to kind of use some of that in the show, but I wanted to watch it with him so we could talk about it as we were watching and kind of connect, you know. You know, and it was so much fun just doing it, and then as something would happen, you know, I would kind of explain, yeah, you know, if we could get, it'd be great to see Bernie and do this type of thing and that. And it was a good experience for us to kind of go through, so when we're on the set, we kind of had the same language of what we wanted, you know.
But it's, sorry.
Well, I'll finish and then you can butt me in. And I did another pilot with James Burroughs, and it was fantastic because, I mean, I was like, wow, James Burroughs, this is great. But he was so respectful of what I had written. You know, he wasn't trying to impose something on me, and we he really helped me a lot too, because he's so experienced, and I really listened to him well when he had some very specific story notes about how to execute something a certain way, when he could feel something might make a difference, and I really listened to him. And the best part of working with him was actually being on the floor creating with him during a certain part of it, and that also helped with the vision of the show. And we're both, I mean, I couldn't believe I'm pitching jokes with Jim Burrows, you know, on the floor. We're making each other laugh. But it was the process of making each other laugh that really bonded us. You know, we had the same kind of vision for it. But he got on my train, as opposed to me feeling like, oh, I'm working with Jim Burrows, God, I hope he likes it, you know, we got him, hopefully I can do this or whatever. And I think that's very important, you know, is to get people to see what you're trying to do and accomplish that.
Chris, how do you disagree with that?
Yeah,
well,
come on.
First of all, there's a very big difference in half hour where you're there on the floor together and you're really working to get a laugh and it's multicam, etc. Right. And a 1 hour where a guy's shooting the whole thing in pieces, you have no real clue as to whether it's going to work or not until you see it more cut together. And also, you're describing the difference between being a writer and a showrunner, which is to say your temperament might be that type where you're a fantastic writer and the last thing in the world you want to do is interface with other people and make a million decisions about what you've written in your script, et cetera, et cetera. You don't particularly care, or your personality isn't the type that wants to physically produce it. Most of the people I think at this table are all writers, but they're also of a managerial or producerial bent. I'm sorry. Look, Mr. Brancato, do you want that wall over there to be brown or red? Red. That's what you do as a producer. Hey, should we cast her or her? Well, you know, okay, I'll cast her, and we'll cast her next episode. That's actually not that hard. What's hard to do is write the script. So in a weird way, you earn the right to produce through your writing, and whether you want to take that burden on is your choice. You can also ask the studio to bring aboard somebody who's a non-writing producer to help you through all that stuff.
But Chris, I'll go a little further with my point, because when I did a single camera show, Ken Kwapis, it is like shooting an hour, but we're on the set and there's a problem and it's like, well, here's what I'm trying to get across story-wise, you know, or I'll sit with Bernie and say, Bernie, you need to, this kid is having a breakdown. You need to communicate with them in a certain way. I'm having conversations about story here, not just making decisions about, you know.
Agreed, but what happens is...
And they're very important decisions that need to be made in the moment about the thing itself.
Yes,
you know?
But I've worked with Ken, and he comes from television, and he also has a very successful feature career,
right.
And he's a dream. Right. You know, I've worked with some 8,000-pound gorilla feature guys,
right,
who are doing their first pilot with me,
right.
And so all through the prep process, it's working and revisions together. We couldn't be closer friends, and then I say to the director the night before the show starts, I say, hey, you know, on the set tomorrow, just so you know, it's not exactly like a feature. I will be conferring with you as to how I see performance,
right,
et cetera, and we'll be talking. And so the director, terrific director, said to me, just understand this, Chris. He said, when I'm on the set, I'm in warrior mode. He goes, I'm in warrior mode. You'll be talking to me, and it might appear that I'm not even listening to you, but I'm hearing everything that's in here. For the next 2 weeks, we shot that pilot. I just was talking to a warrior who didn't accomplish anything I asked about,
right,
the way the character should be done. And that pilot suffered as a result of that.
Right, which goes back to my point. That's your job, is to make sure that doesn't happen.
Right.
You know, and that's what I'm trying to say.
And the interesting
I would
thing
never, ever, ever hire a feature director for a pilot, ever, because I think that television is so specific in the way it's directed. I think it's such an art form, directing TV in and of itself, that I think those guys let them go learn on somebody else's show.
Well,
you're correct, but there's also an imperative from the network. Oh my God, you can get Brian Singer, you can get Antoine Fuqua to do a pilot. Oh my God, we'd love that.
I think it's also though.
No.
I think it's also it's managing.
I write
also, it is.
I know. I would never.
It's managing and meshing personalities and with all of this, with all the advice and all of this, a lot of it really does come back to luck and praying. And I'll tell you what happened on my pilot is
right, pray. love.
Is amazing. I mean, no one would direct this pilot. I mean, there wasn't one person in this town who even mildly thought it was mildly amusing. I mean, even my agent, I got the coverage from my agency about this is one of the worst scripts we've ever read. If maybe if William Goldman did a pass on it, it would have some semblance of something worth viewing. But anyway, everyone passed, and then one guy, David Frankel, who's a very good friend of mine, who did Devil Wears Prada and Marley and Me, he had passed on the Sex and the City pilot.
But he started in TV.
Yeah, but he passed on the Sex and the City pilot. Anyway, they said maybe David Frankel, and I called a couple of people like I always do, even though nobody wanted to do it. I'm checking references, and I called my friend David Schwimmer, did Band of Brothers. I said, David Frankel, what do you think of this guy? Genius, the greatest thing in the world, but be careful, he's 300 pounds. If you're in the heat, you might have a problem. Literally, this is what he tells me. So anyway, I call David Frankel and I beg him. He finally agrees to come. Guy shows up. He's 6 feet, 170, in perfect shape. At the moment I swear to God, the moment he walks in the office, my phone rings. David Schwimmer calls, and I go, oh, this is so funny. David Frankel just walked in the door. Hold on. I put him on the phone, and they're like, hey, and I just see, and it hits me. They don't know each other at all. Okay? David Schwimmer's talking. Who is one of the best directors in the television business. And now I'm now sitting there going, I have no idea who this guy is, what he's done, or why he's here. And the amazing thing that happened with David, forgetting directing, David's a genius writer, and he actually helped this script. I mean, the script that I'd worked on for 3 years that, you know, again, we talk about notes. HBO's biggest notes was, no heart, just fun. No conflict, just fun. Now, if anyone, whoever writes here, try writing with no conflict, okay? But I had finally figured it out, where to the point where I handed it to, you know, my partner, and I said, okay, I've literally written a script where nothing happens. They go to a party, they take some girls home, they take them out for drinks, they take them back home, they bang them here, they bang them there. And I said, this is the worst thing I've written in 15 years out here. And HBO greenlit it. They said, that's a go.
So yeah, you got something.
So when David Frankel came on, he said, what the fuck is this? Nothing happens. And that script was literally rewritten in the last 3 days. I mean, almost entirely from what the first 3 years of notes and this and that was, and sort of got back to where it was 3 years earlier. And David, of course, did a great job, and we got along great, but I mean, it was a miracle. I mean, anybody else, I mean, even David Nutter is a genius, he might have loved that script, and we would have ended up with nothing. So so it's funny how things happen. But
what do you do when, as you're saying, the ship is going, is listing, perhaps even sinking, as is happening?
What well, do you I'm do? A neurotic Jew from New York. The ship is always sinking. You know, but you gotta keep fighting through everything. I mean, every day there is another battle. Every day there is another
problem. Every hour.
Yeah.
You know,
you just don't panic.
Right.
And you realize that every problem has a finite amount of solutions. You have smart people around you, and you pick the best solution, and you just keep going.
But recast in the middle?
I've fired people, and I was an actor too, so it's really hard to fire. I had to fire the lead of my show about, at the end of the table read, I had to fire the lead of my show. And I was actually, if my pilot had gone, there was a lead that was going to be fired. And recently, and she, so funny, oh, I just said she, but she was just quoted in the newspaper saying, oh, you know, I just did this pilot and I was so worried about being tied to a 6-year deal. And I was like, honey, you don't know. You were out of there. But I find that the line producer is also essential. And I like to get these, you know, really calm, really old timers who, and the minute they say,
very, very important.
I had the line on this last pilot. I had the guy who did was the line producer of the pilot of Heroes. That was just an incredible, you know, and he's three generations in the business. And I was interviewing line producers, and I said, when I say jump, I need you to say how high. I don't need the no. Let's work it out. Because a lot of line producers will say, we can't afford that, we can't do that, we can't. And it's like, well, then I can't work with you. we don't have to spend more money. Let's figure out, I need to know that you're there to work with this production team to figure out the best, you're going to facilitate that.
That goes back to what Doug and Larry were saying, is that there's sort of two kinds of line producers, the ones that are working for the studio,
right,
and the ones that are trying to help you tell your story.
Right.
And the ones that are working for the studio will sit on set behind your director and look at their watch, and the ones that are helping you tell your story will figure out how to get your day done and root for you. And it's essential that you have somebody who's working for you and not for the studio.
Yeah, and they're digging money out of the budget. I met with this one line producer, and I'm the only woman on this panel, but I met with this guy, he's a real tough guy, and he sat down, he goes, this is the one question I have. Did you actually write this script? And I went, I'm so sorry, I don't know what you mean. And he went, well, you know, there's a lot of technical. I mean, did you write this script? And I was like, he goes, because you know, on TV there's a lot of writers. And this guy's produced a ton of pilots. And I went, no, but it was so great to meet you, and thank you so much for coming. And I was like, man. And I called Marta Kaufman, because he had worked with her. And I said, Marta, am I taking this the wrong way? He asked me if I wrote this. And she went, that fucking douchebag. And I went, all right, thank you. I'm so sorry, but thank you for saying that, because I was like, I'm still in shock. She goes, well, you know, I am an 800-pound gorilla, so he would never ask me if I wrote my script myself, you know. But I remember thinking, I go, well, you won't be my line producer. And then, you know, and I just kept going, because there's also, you know, when you're a woman doing this and you're not Marta, there is a second, you know, you're working with an all-male crew. It's pretty much all dudes there. So you have to find someone who's not afraid and doesn't have those preconceived notions. And I find the way to be on a set is that I'm just unbelievably calm at all times. Absolutely nothing fazes me. I am unruffled at all times, no matter what. And that's the only way because, you know, I get completely neurotic getting notes and all that stuff, but when it kind of, which I sort of hide, but on a set and in production, you have to be calm. You must be calm. It is an express train. It's not making local stops. You are moving. It is not going to stop moving. So you have to go where it's moving. You know, you have to stay with it and stay unbelievably calm and centered.
So I'd like to open it up to questions. We've got another 15, half hour-ish, so let's start from this side of the room. This man? We'll do the microphone business, and you'll stand up so everybody can hear you and see you. There you go.
You don't need a mic. Thank you. Larry, I just have to start off and say this. To the white meat shows, I fell on the floor.
Oh, thank you.
I just fell on the floor, because if that wasn't my mother, whoo! Anyway, I'm out of jail, so she did a good job. I mean, I never went to jail. So I went to college, not to jail, so she did a good job. She was just like that.
The line that Bernie Mac's "I'll bust your head to the white meat" shows.
Yeah, that was just brilliant. But I have a question for you. You said you sold 24 pilots. Did you sell the concept, the scripts, because it seems like listening to the panel, that it's just the idea. You go in and pitch an idea. You don't need a script.
Oh, no, I pitched the ideas, okay. Then wrote the scripts, then many of them became pilots, but never got to series. One actually, I lied for the joke, but one actually became a series. But you know, my track record is
called The Simpsons.
Much worse than their record.
But this is what I don't understand. Do you not? So you don't pitch a pilot? That's my question. Like, you don't go in if you meet with the producer?
No, you do. You pitch. I mean, if you're asking me, I'm the moderator, but it's supposed to be their questions. But no, I go in and I pitch an idea for a show and the characters and the setting and all those things, and I do exactly what Chris does. You know, I try to get them excited and tell them. I sometimes lie and say, this happened to me and it's my life and it's my story and all that kind of stuff, and then you get them to buy it, and then once they buy it, then you have to go through the process of what everybody's talking about.
So they buy the pitch, they don't buy the script. That's
they
my
buy
question.
Both. They buy both.
Well, they pay you to write a script,
right?
No,
and
but
write
no, I'm saying script. If you go in with the script, that's
you
what
can
I'm
write
saying.
A script, but you wouldn't go in. You just show them the script, and they would buy that or not.
Oh, okay.
Which is very rare.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It helps if they're already paying you that they're going to pick it up.
It's what Margaret said earlier too. They want to
get invested.
Feel like, yeah, they want to be invested and feel like they're as involved as possible. And if something hasn't been written yet, they can feel like they're really giving input to that thing. It's some of it's psychological. Who knows, you know? But
Year, a couple of speculative pilot scripts are bought. Like for instance, this year ABC's putting on Happy Town, which was a spec script written by writers. Almost Desperate Housewives was a spec script written by Mark Cherry. So every year you can tout out an example of something somebody wrote that got into the system and got bought and made. But the most efficient way to try to get your show on the air is to go pitch it to the network, have them buy the pitch, allow you to write the script, or pay you to write the script, and it gets developed internally that way. That way they're invested in it.
Sean Ryan's show, The Shield, was sold by accident, almost. Kevin Riley took over FX. I think it was just on his desk or something. It was something Sean had written. And Riley read it and said, "What the fuck is this? You know, this is fantastic. Why aren't we making this?" And he actually, you know, called Sean and asked him if he would make it and everything. And I think Sean's head was past that already because he had.
No, he had written it for Viacom 2 years before. I had the unfortunate luck of competing against The Shield.
Yeah.
My pilot went against The Shield.
And then it didn't make it, I guess. I mean, his pilot at that time.
His pilot made it.
Right. With FX, right.
Yes.
Right.
But you're right. It was laying on a slush pile. They decided they wanted to try to do some original programming, and they started to read all the scripts that were dead pilots.
So there you go. I mean, it's just sitting around.
And Sopranos was a dead pilot, too.
That's right, at Fox.
And ER was a dead feature script.
For 20 years, wasn't it?
Yeah.
ER was around
for a long time.
Yeah.
Yes. Michael Crichton got the idea in the 70s, actually.
I just have a question. When you're writing a pilot script as more of a calling card, you know, if you're a newer writer, as opposed to, you know, with the expectation that it's going to get made, do you advise people to go to write something that's more self-contained, like a serialized one, or, you know, there's so many shows out like Damages or The Wire where it's an episodic arc? Which do you think is more appropriate for using a pilot script as a calling card?
As a calling card, you should write something that minds your voice, because that's what you're going to be selling as a calling card, your ability to write and your voice. So wherever you feel that falls, whatever you're attracted to, whatever kinds of characters that you think are going to highlight who you are as a writer is what you should be doing.
And at the same time, I personally wouldn't write, even though I like writing these shows, like I wouldn't write a CSI procedural that's dry as the voice pilot. I would write something darker rather than lighter, is my opinion, and something with a heck of a cliffhanger at the end. It should just make you desperate to read in the next episode.
As a baby writer, I was just wondering if you had any comments on having your agents in pitches, whether or not you think it's beneficial for them to do all that chit-chat, or if you think it's more distracting.
I don't look at Doug as a baby writer.
Is that to me?
Well,
no.
It's to
anyone, but yeah. I mean, I
what's the question?
Only I wouldn't have my agent in a pitch. That one time with Ari, because it was Ari, and he's pretty powerful. But I think it's much, you know, I don't think they want to hear from the agent. I think they want to hear from you.
Oftentimes, you will have an agent in the pitch if you go on the network, if the agency is looking to get their packaging fee, so they'll feel like they need to be represented. In that situation, you guys should know when you go into the room who's going to talk and when, because you don't want somebody to come in and throw your rhythm off of something that you've practiced. A lot of times, they're just maintaining their presence because you're the client and they're hoping to get a packaging fee off the show.
Okay. I have another question also, if that's okay. When you get studio notes that you don't understand, how much should you try to push them to elaborate?
Again, in the moment, well, you can obviously in the moment say, can you just clarify that and see if their explanation makes sense the second time around? If it doesn't, then I, again, let time pass and then call them back and say, hey, I'm just not great. I wanna try to address this note. I just don't understand it.
It helps in two ways. It helps that you seem interested in their note,
right,
and excited by what was that great thing that you just said. They won't be offended by you asking the question. They like the attention, so that helps. And even if it's a terrible note that you reject later, at least you seemed very concerned about it.
So I tell you what works too, especially on a pilot. particularly if the studio has a lot of notes, it's good to meet in person instead of on the phone, because sometimes you can hash out what they're really trying to get at if you're in person. Like if you show them, I'm not quite sure what you're saying, now they're forced to kind of explain a little more, and get them into explaining what feels like a problem as opposed to trying to get into fixing something. Like, I always try to get them away from fixing and just into diagnosing. Because diagnosis is very helpful. If they feel like a moment doesn't work, I want that information. But I don't necessarily want them to get into trying to fix it for me. I said, well, I'll do that. But it's good if I hear something doesn't quite play, because then I think, well, why doesn't that play? Why isn't that not coming across? And then I'll figure out how to do it. But I try to get that from them more than anything else. So sitting down in person is a good way to get that out, as opposed to getting notes on paper or talking on the phone. They're always distracted on the other end. You can't see, but there's something going on.
Yeah, you should always meet with them in person. And then, and if you don't understand, I always make friends with the baby development executive, because they won't be bothered taking my call. They'll be happy to take my call, and then they'll go ask and try and find out what the note really means. And then, you know, I have a relationship with someone who is ultimately going to run the studio one day. So it's a win-win. But don't, I always never ignore those baby development executives.
Whoever, that gentleman there has it.
So you're not an established name, but you get a pitch meeting and the network or studio likes it, but you're not an experienced showrunner or TV producer. Do they try to partner you up with somebody who is experienced? How does that work if you're not an established name?
Yes, that is what they do. I think they're interested in hearing any kind of idea that sounds like it could be a winner, and actually they don't care that much who it comes from for that very reason, because they know they can take a young, talented writer or a talented writer they haven't heard of before and put them with quote-unquote experienced showrunners who will help that person guide their pilot through the script stage. If it gets picked up, those non-writing producers or production pod, whatever you want to call it, will help you to make your pilot. Yeah, exactly.
Baby writer.
Nice. That's what I do at Disney.
but I think it's very important when they're trying to hook you up with someone that you sit down and you talk to the people, because like Larry said, you all want to be making the same show, and there's some people who will come in and try and make it their show, which might not be what anybody wanted to begin with. I mean, you know, if they're excited about you and they're interested in the script, it's because they like the voice. So you need somebody who's going to, you know, be able to run the show, be able to run the room, be able to make sure that the scripts come in time, in on time, and be able to do all the rewrites that are necessary very quickly to make sure that the production train goes when you go to the series. But you got to make sure that you're at the initial conversations that you're all making the same show.
And it's a good problem to have.
Yeah.
It means that, you know, they might be making your thing. It's a great problem to have, you know.
That's just microphone.
I was wondering if any advice you can give on this, if you've written something that is a vehicle for yourself to act in, how you would go about pitching that.
I guess I've done it. I don't know if anybody else. I'm actually did that now with HBO. I'm writing something for myself. It is a different animal, because, you know, you kind of distance yourself a little bit at the same time. You know, you're involved. But what was the specific question about it?
Well, she wants to know how she can make herself a star.
Oh, okay.
Exactly. In my own, I've written something that is for a character that I've done before and that I've played. And So when you go in and you pitch, is there, you know, do you bring that character to the table as you're pitching it? I mean, have you had that experience?
Where did you do this character?
Not sure.
On stage?
But the reality is that you have to be a value add to the network.
Right.
And so if you've played this character in a way where they can feel like it's a brand name identity, like, you know, Roseanne Barr had a very big stand-up career and was well known nationally, as was Tim Allen, as was
Jerry Seinfeld.
Yeah, Jerry Seinfeld. So they're just going to look at you and do the math. Does this help us promote the show? Does this help us get viewers? Otherwise, it's a hard road. So, you know, that's the unfortunate reality of
The one way to do it is to, if you have Showcase or whatever, and you get the network somehow get them down wanted to see you do this character, and then suddenly they fall in love with it, and then you have this material that they also fall in love with. It's very hard, but that's how you would do it. Other people I know who have done that with their character, they've written the script and said, I'd like to play it, but it may not be me. I would give it up to somebody else, and that's a lot easier to sell.
Yeah, you may not be right for your thing that you think you are right for sometimes. It's true, you know. I mean, Carl Reiner wasn't right for his own show.
The Dick Van Dyke Show.
It was written for himself, and he actually filmed a pilot with himself in it, and he just wasn't better. He wasn't as good as Dick Van Dyke, you know. Who was, in fact, he admitted it was pretty bad with him in it.
And the other thing is to know that the writing comes first. If they love the script so much that they need to have it, they need to have it beyond the shadow of a doubt, you could say, as Sylvester Stallone did, no, I will not sell you Rocky for somebody else to play. I have to play Rocky. And they wanted it so bad they allowed him to play Rocky, even though he had done a tiny little part on Lords of Flatbush. That was it. So, in other words, his writing was so exquisite.
He had a particular vision.
And that was in the feature film world. In a whole different time.
And the movie was so cheap.
Yes.
Some questions on this side. We only have time for a couple more questions. So this young lady.
We can hear her. She's close enough.
Yeah. I just wanted to get clarification. You have alluded to studio versus network. Would you just clarify the roles of each kind of in this process?
Yes. There are five major networks, CW, NBC, ABC, CBS. Does NBC fit in that category anymore? Fox,
CW.
ABC. Yeah. In any case, five major broadcast networks. Each one of them is aligned to one degree or another with a sister studio. The network is the broadcaster who puts your show on television. The studio is the banker who partners with you to finance the show. So when we talk about working with the studio, that's our financial partner, and we're trying to make a show for the studio's sister, who is the network. It's all generally under the same roof these days. It used to be different.
Cable, they're one and the same.
Not always.
Not always.
It depends.
HBO is very proprietary, and they don't like making deals with these studios. They like to own their own product. That little lady over there seems very anxious.
Hi. I hate to be a dog with a bone, but you're talking about pitching and making something relatable. I recently met one of the writers of House, and I was asking him about pitching. He said, well, David Shore said, I want to make a cop show, but the cop's going to be a doctor, and he's going to hate his patients. And they said, go ahead, go make it. Well, he's David Shore, and they know he's going to execute. If you don't have a brand name like David Shore or David Chase, how much do you have to go into the characters, and do you have a particular process in terms of how and what you want to pitch when you go into pitch?
Can I since I sold a pilot, having never written a pilot before, you have to make it indisputable. They don't know who you are, you have no track record, and you must be indisputable. And you must go into your characters, and you must have the most practice, the most exciting, charming, thrilling pitch for them, because you know, I had a movie script, I had a movie that had been made, but other than that, they didn't know that I could do this. So you have to, the first hurdle is that pitch and creating that world of the show and laying it out for them and not talking too long, but telling them enough and really investing in it so they feel safe. You know, they don't have to, they're safe with the name. David Shore just walks in the room, they're safe. You're unsafe. So if they're going to spend that much money to buy a script from you, you better lay it out on the table for them. You know, it's not like, there are those restaurants where they're so fancy, they just serve you whatever they're cooking that night, and you know it's going to be good. Other restaurants, there has to be a menu. Mm-hmm. You got to give them a menu. You know, they'll see if they want to order.
It serves you whatever you want.
Last question over there, that gentleman.
Did not know that.
Hi, this question is for Margaret. You mentioned that you like Hung, and I love that show as well, and the relationship between the characters is phenomenal. And I also noticed that Alexander Payne directed the pilot, and you said that you don't particularly like working with big-name directors.
It was a big, I know, because I have a lot of friends who worked on Hung at every level, is that he came in, rewrote the script, and then they went back to the original script, which to me is just crazy, because he's a writer and a director. And then the pilot ended up being 40 minutes long for a 30-minute time slot. I think the pilot would have been better served had it been within 30 minutes. But again, because, so Alexander Payne, I think because he was a writer-director, there was like a real power struggle with him and the creators of the show, which now that the show is in the hands of the creators of the show, I'm really enjoying it so much more.
I really felt like the pilot struggled when I was watching it.
Yeah.
It really struggled, and I felt those fingerprints on it.
I really felt it would have been much better served with a TV director on that pilot. Because he would have known how to tell that story in less, which is what so much of what TV's about is telling a story in less, not more. And that's sort of the brilliance of TV as well, the fun of TV. So.
Because it looked very pretty, very cinematic, but I don't know how good of a job he did of establishing the characters and the premise of the series.
Yeah, fuck him, man. Screw him in the paint. What's he doing? We don't need him in our little TV world.
History.
Get him out.
I'd like to thank our panel. Thank you very much. And also, before we go, I'd like to wish a very happy birthday to Chris Brancato, 29 today. Happy birthday. Thank you very much.